What's happening? What's happening, family? Time to rock and roll. How y'all doing out there? Oh, yeah. Another edition of Chop Talk with Orlando Predators head coach, Doug Miller. Welcome to the show once again.
Thank you for having me. Thanks for having me once again.
Oh, absolutely, sir, absolutely. I mean, I'm sure some of us are still filled up with that good barbecue we had yesterday at the picnic. We went to Wakaba Islands. Hey, Big Pat was on the grill, Milton doing his thing, and the rest of the ladies, y'all did y'all things on the sides. I like that, I like that, I like that. Well, we're going to get right into it. I got to say, Coach, that was one hell of a game on Friday. One hell of a game.
Yeah, the guys, you know, finally decided to come together. We made a couple changes again. But the showing that we put out Friday night, I'm not, of course, 100% happy, but for the most part, I'm happy that we was able to compete and to give the fans a show.
And speaking of the fans, the arena was swole. It was really swole, I must say. I'm talking about from left side, right side, end zone. It was fabulous.
Yeah, they it kind of reminded me of the old jungle at the old Amway.
It was rocking.
Because it was pretty loud, you know.
Yeah, it was.
So to get that feeling to for the guys to feel that juice again, or for them the first time.
Right,
for
yeah.
It was awesome. It was an awesome feeling.
Catching the game live and feeling that action once again, it was definitely something that the fans have been looking for. It was great scoring, great competitiveness out there, and didn't get the outcome you wanted. But you showed signs of if we can stay together, the best yet come. So we're going to get a little some stat sheets here for a second. We're going to get into some stats. First quarter, goes to your opponent, 15-6. Second quarter, kind of stepped up, 14-14. Third quarter, 14-8. And you got another quarter that you won. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Fourth quarter, overtime, you were outscored 24-3. Take us through the moments of that fourth quarter and what happened?
Going into the fourth quarter, I believe we were up. And in the arena, you always need to score. And we were in a position where we stalled a little bit offensively. Some things didn't go our way. A couple bad bounces. Had a fumble on the third down, which we were going to try field goal to go up by 9 at one point. Mm-hmm. So we struggled a little bit in the fourth quarter. Partly, I blame myself on the play calling offensively. Maybe I wasn't as aggressive in the fourth quarter as I had been previously in the other quarter. But, you know, losing that game, part of the rebuilding process, meaning that you know, you have to teach your guys how to finish. So the process of us being able to be competitive that game was good. Yet, as a team, we still wasn't able to finish. You've lost, you know, 11 games this year. You're in a position where you're so used to losing that it becomes comfortable. And that's not a good feeling, you know. So, you know, we'll go into this week, and we will focus on finishing, you know, closing a team out, you know, continuing putting points on the board, having the defense step up, because it was their time to step up and hold that offense. But we struggled a little bit in the fourth quarter.
Now, during that fourth quarter overtime period, a offensive standpoint, defensive standpoint, do you feel that guys let gas just a little bit right? We just start just trying to manage it instead of continuing doing what you're doing. You feel you guys kind of like let up a little bit on both sides of the ball?
No, I don't think mentally they let up. They probably were a little comfortable because I believe this was the second game of the season that we went into halftime with a lead. So, you know, I had an old coach, you know, when you score touchdowns, you celebrate. He always say, act like you've been there before. Ooh. These guys really hadn't been there before with this lead this year. So, in a sense, maybe they didn't know how to act because, you know, it wasn't intentionally to let off the gas, but maybe they did let off the gas a little bit because we had such a big lead and they made it a tight game and things just didn't go our way in the fourth quarter.
So what did you tell your team in the locker room with a bunch of guys who were not used to being up at halftime? What was your halftime speech to them?
0-0. You know, got to come out. We was only up 9 points. We came out. We received the ball. We scored a touchdown. But we started the third quarter off like I wanted to. But in the locker room, I just told them it was 0-0, and we had to continue to fight. We had to finish this ball game. And that was my message to them at halftime.
Seems as if going out into the third quarter, you guys were able to put up 14 more points and that lead before they decided to score 8 points, either midway or close to the end of that third quarter, where momentum somewhat started to shift. Call pass in the back of the end zone. It was number 0. Thinking that was the only touchdown that they scored going into the third quarter. Kind of start turning the tide fourth quarter because they scored 15.
Yeah, that was third quarter, towards the end of the third quarter. I believe it was
third and long. And we just had a phone play by one of our guys. Sitting in cover 3 defense. A pass that shouldn't have been allowed.
But you get in the
backfield, you get you every time, man. And I don't think that was the momentum shift. I think the momentum shift a little bit was when unfortunately, A.J. Harmon of the Columbus Lions got hurt. And it was about a 20 to 30 minute intermission, in a sense.
Yes.
So when you look up at the scoreboard as a player, you say, we got this, you know. So that's probably when the foot will let off the gas a little bit because they're looking at the time, looking at the score. Thinking if we can get through these last 9 minutes, we're good to go. So that was a shift.
Absolutely. Now, number 99, have you heard anything about him? How's his condition?
I haven't heard much. I know he did have surgery. So he's just on the road to recovery here in the offseason.
Okay. Now, you brought in a new quarterback, Brian Smith, after a couple of weeks given Matt Parsons, vote of confidence. What was it about Brian that convinced the coaching staff that he was a better fit at this point in the game, or in the season, I should say?
As a head coach, it wasn't a tough decision. You know, I wanted to stick with Matt, and not release him, and let him get a feel for the offense. However, as a coach, when you have double-digit interceptions in 2 games, it's tough, keep putting that same product on the field. The fans deserve so much better.
Right.
So when we brought Brian in, again, I don't know when they're practice. Brian had never played a league football before.
Wow.
Never snapped a ball ever. Hit with defenses. I told him one time what the defenses are. He didn't ask another question. He was quick with his decision making. He had a quick release. He was very athletic, and I thought to myself after that day of practice, and was going to another practice of Mother Nature again. But I thought to myself, this kid can possibly help us win the ball game, although he had never played before. I figured it couldn't get no worse at the position. So we gave him a shot, and he made it pretty good.
Wow, I mean, looking pretty good is an understatement. You ask the fans, that brought some electricity in that building.
Right.
You know, breaking down the sideline, scoring touchdowns, moving the pocket, going from, you know, shrinking the pocket from here and expanding it to there. Even though he's short, he's not Matt Parsons height, but with him being able to scramble around, move the pocket to be able to make those reads downfield, he definitely brought excitement to the game. So,
and you know, that was a question that he asked, because he was a running quarterback in college. And he said, hey, coach, can I run the ball? And I say, really, in arena, there are no running lanes, you know, so it's going to be tough for you to run the ball. However, as an athlete and a guy that's so quick, if you do move out of the pocket, you can create running lanes, you know, from just scrambling. But it has to be very quick. And that was something, I think his first touchdown was a scramble, and he took off and he made me look good.
Now, speaking of looking good, you were calling the plays on Friday. How comfortable were you having to call the plays, being that you haven't called them all season long?
Well, I've been an OC before down in Tampa. There were some personal reasons why I didn't take the helm this year. Some things that I needed to get right in my life, you know, and to be, or to have less stress as possible. But after going through, you know, a couple of coordinators, and the reason, you know, that I brought my coordinators in, the former quarterbacks, was not because I couldn't call the plays, but I wanted to bring in guys that played the position before, and what that does is help the quarterback get in the rhythm.
Right.
Didn't quite work out the way, you know, that I planned, so I took the helm this week with no problem. Put together a game plan with the new quarterback. We met for hours after hours after hours, and put together a plan and went out and tried to execute as best as we could.
Okay. Now, there were a couple of plays down the stretch, including the end of regulation, where you guys had an opportunity to possibly kick a game-winning field goal, you know, with your kicker, Nick. Now, he's already made a two-point conversion from that distance in the game already. So, was there a decision that you were puzzled whether or not you should go for it, or was it already set that we're just going to go in overtime?
There was no thought process at all as far as at the end of the game kicking a field goal from the five-yard line. We've been in that situation a couple of times this year, and they've been returning for touchdowns, because when you kick a field goal, you have nothing but big guys on the field. And you want them to get in their lanes, but it's a tough situation when you're able to return it if we don't reach, you know, back of the end zone. So there was no thought process at all, because although he had made a two-point conversion, when you're kicking a field goal from that deep, there's low trajectory on the ball starting off. So there's a big difference between trying that and the deuce, because with the deuce, you have nobody in front of you.
Right.
So you can start the ball as low as you want to. When you're kicking a field goal from that team, you know, you got those big guys in front of you. And I don't know if you noticed their offensive and defensive line, they probably averaged about 6 points. So very easy for them to get a hand on the ball, block it, score, and win the ball game. So I thought our best situation was to go into overtime and, you know, try to outplay them in overtime.
Now, to rewind just a little bit, even before going into overtime, before they scored, there was a crucial moment in the game where you guys were up and Brian fumbled, not by, you know, pressure, it just one of them tough rules.
Right.
That slipped out of his hands, the ball was already out before the hand went forward. Was there any type of reasoning as to why the clock didn't ran out so that you could kick a field goal to go up by nine?
Well, that was the plan after that third down play if we didn't convert, was to kick a field goal and go up by nine. The ball slipped out of Ryan's hand, which has happened, you know, multiple times this year between either our quarterback or the opposing quarterback. And the problem that we had this game was we had brand new balls that were just opened up minutes before the game.
Wow.
So it wasn't, we didn't have the time to rub the balls down so they had a good grip. You watch the replay, I mean, it just completely slipped out of his hands. He's a kid, although he's short, he has big hands. So no, you know, physical reason why that would happen besides the fact that it was a brand new ball and it was just a little slippery, which has happened throughout the course of the season this year. And that was a big play because, like I said, in my head, you know, Nick had already made a deuce. He had already made a kick and field goal. So I had no reason not to believe that we was going to go up by 9 points. Again, that was just an unfortunate situation. A play that, you know, you would love to get back and say, hey, I could have ran that ball, still kick a field goal, but that's Monday morning quarterback.
Right, exactly, absolutely. So we're going to switch gears, and it's that time of the show that fans get to come be on CFTV in front of the crowd and ask Coach Doug Miller those tough questions. So when we get back, we'll take a quick pause, and we'll be back. So keep it locked. The best is yet to come. Let's go. Welcome back. Oh, man, it's that time of the show where the fans get to ask Coach the tough questions. Before we begin, we talked about number 99 from Columbus Lions who laid on the carpet motionlessly, was able to get up, and he chimed in tonight, and he wanted to say, hey, Orlando fans, I wanted to say thank you for all so much from the bottom of my heart. When I was laying down on the field in pain, I heard you all prayers and chants. Thank you all so much. It meant a lot, and I'll never, ever forget it. And I'm so thankful for the love you all showed. I had surgery yesterday, and it was very successful. Thank you again. Hashtag Roar Lions Roar. Hashtag Go Preds Go. Hashtag The Jungle Family. Speedy recovery, my brother. All right. We have a fan that would like to ask Coach a question, and this is first time on TV, and he's quite excited. Welcome to the show.
Go ahead and tell everybody your name.
Kyle.
All right. What question do you have for Coach?
The question is, when we were up 20 points in the second half, did, like, anything change, or did we, like, stay the same? Like,
that's a good question.
With our formation, how we approach the game.
Right, and that's a great question. Did anything change? No, play calling wise, nothing changed. We just had, you know, like I said, you know, a couple bad bounces. We might have had some guys that were a little lax simply because we were up by so much. Play calling wise, nothing changed. We still wanted to attack the team. We still wanted to put points on the board. They possibly made some changes that we didn't adjust to, you know, especially, you know, with our defensive coordinator, James Lynch, you know, being suspended. He couldn't make the adjustments that, you know, that possibly would have been made.
You have another question for Coach.
Hopefully the Predators are going to be this year. I don't know. I hope so.
Yeah, we should be back next year. I don't see a reason why not.
What team did you coach before you coached Orlando? Did you win for a while?
Right. So
in the storm.
So I started with my career with Orlando, and then I went and I coached 2 years in New Orleans, and then I went to Tampa.
Okay.
And full circle, now I'm back home in Orlando.
Okay. Okay, I'm done with the questions.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
You're no stranger to the show. You got that grill going. Hey, that's some good corn. That's some good corn, by the way.
Thank you. Well, I'm straight, large family, 10 kids. I'm the oldest, so I've learned how to cook fast.
Looking for a try.
Well, I'm a southern boy. I still got cowboy boots, and so there you go. I'll never get the south out of it.
What question do you have for Coach tonight, sir?
Coach, I know this week, one of my main questions are they bringing any players in, or are you going to try to keep this group intact and try to bring a win Saturday night in Jacksonville? I know I'm looking forward to being over there and enjoying the game. We'll be right as close as I can to you yelling at the Predators Saturday night. So, you know, I'm just kind of curious to what are we doing this week?
This week, we should have the same roster that we had last week, barring injuries.
Yay! I love it. I love it. The guys brought so much energy Saturday night. I mean, we're up in the club section with our cowbells, and I'm looking down, and I've never seen people more excited and getting up cheering, because usually you just got a few people cheering, but everybody actually was in that game Friday night, and I'm really so proud of
that. Yeah, it was rocking. It was definitely an exciting game. It takes a lot for me to get excited. And I mean, every score, you know, I was down midfield, you know, just, you know, pumping the crowd over, fist pump, whatever. I was excited, you know. And when you go through a season like we've been through this year, when you finally get, you know, to competitive games and be able to go out and do some things for the fans, it's very exciting. And I know that's what, you know, you guys been waiting on. It's what I've been waiting on as a coach for the players to finally respond. And they did, and hopefully we can keep that rolling, you know, going to Jacksonville this week and roll that over to next year.
But Coach, I want to say one last thing is good luck Saturday night. Go Predators. We're hoping to have 25-plus people more behind your bench, and we're going to be cheering for you.
Thank you, Milton. I appreciate it.
Thank you. What else we're doing, guys? One more question. Yes. Come on up, sir. Welcome to the set.
Well, thanks. Coach, I thought it was a great game to start with, and the excitement was going through the whole place. Two things. Number one, and correct me how you feel on this, but that onside kick. The ball, it looked to me like the ball might have gone out of bounds, but evidently it didn't. So, what's your thought on that?
Right. Probably wouldn't have to get into the onside kick. We had some responsibility as the receiving team on that that we didn't do. No matter if the ball was going out or not, we still were supposed to do our job and we didn't, you know? So the ball wasn't out. Him recovering the ball on the dashboard is legal.
Okay, so...
So the ball is in bounds.
All right, because I wasn't sure on that, and I was praying it was out of bounds.
Right, right. I was praying, too, but I knew that my prayers wouldn't be answered, so I don't believe it. But that was a critical play. Another bonehead play that we had, during the second half. If we can get a hand on that guy at all, it doesn't happen. If we knock the ball out of bounds, it doesn't happen. And those are two things we didn't do.
Well, I guarantee it won't happen again.
I can guarantee it too.
And one other question. I've noticed that most of the teams that come in have more beef than we have. And in the secondary, I feel bad for the secondary because height-wise and weight-wise, we're kind of outweighed.
Right, and that plays into, us being able, as a coaching staff, to get the players that we're looking for. Because other teams do come in with bigger receivers. Typically, the DBs are smaller than the receivers, and they're a little quicker. So they are able to body out DBs a little bit, and the quarterbacks can throw them open because they're so big. But that, like I said, that goes into having a full offseason and being able to get, some of the, and not saying that we don't have some of the guys that we want, but to be able to get a full rotation of the guys that we want, guys that, if they are smaller, can still, play good defense against bigger receivers. Last week, we just didn't have that. We lost our defensive coordinator for one game. We also lost two of our starting defensive backs, and Chris Pickett and Roman Tatum for the year. So we had two guys back there that hadn't played all year long. So it was a tough year.
Well, you had two interceptions.
Right.
And then I'm going to leave. I noticed at the beginning of the game, you had the team out there. It looked like it was a practice. And it showed on the field. Because I looked at it and I said, wow, they're running through all their plays and they're really going through it. And I think, I've never seen that before. So was that the first time you've done that?
Right. Well, what we did was try to make pregame like a walkthrough. We ran through a couple plays at half speed or three-quarter speed at least. Of course, no banging, but just to get the guys' juices flowing a little bit. That way we can come in the game and we are already ready to rock and roll, opposed to, going to the game and still being a little cold. So I warm them up a little longer or a little harder this week, opposed to previous weeks.
Very impressive. Thank you, Coach.
Thank you very much.
Once again, that was a very exciting game, and I'm still replaying it, in my head. And, as a coach myself, of course, there's no moral victories. It's always what you learn from it. And if it's anything that, looking from the outside in, is being able to adjust to what just happened, which means, going into the film room, studying the film, looking at what happened. Now, to play against Jacksonville Sharks, they're no strangers. You haven't beat them yet. And it's going to be a tough task once again. Now, some of these guys may or may not have played against them, but as a coaching staff, you guys have seen any and everything about them. How do you get your guys prepared for a team that has had your number all season long? How do you prepare them, motivate them, even though you guys have officially been eliminated from playoff contentions? How do you get them to play for the last game of the season?
Well, some of these guys, you never, in football, you never know when is your last game. So every game you have to play it like it's your last game. So for, some of our guys that, everybody's a free agent after this game. So a lot of guys are still playing to, get picked up next year, either by Orlando or any other team. So they don't want to go into that game and lay down. The way that you motivate them, you go through the same thing that you always do, and try to mentally get them prepared. get the guys just to be able to believe that they can be defeated, then we have a chance.
Now, just to play devil's advocate just a little bit here, we both know the game, especially when it's the last game of the year. You're the number one seed, getting ready for playoffs. What type of Jacksonville team do you feel you guys are going to play? A team that's going to be giving their 100% as if that's their playoff game, or a team that's, hey, you know what, let's just play the game and not get hurt?
You know, just speaking aside earlier, head coach of Jacksonville, they're going to come in as if it's a regular game. They're trying to win a ball game. When you, you know, play a football game and you play not to get hurt, it's usually when you get hurt. You know, we're in a game that doesn't have too many backup positions, so it's not as if their second team is going to be playing this whole game. So they're going to come out and they're going to try to win the ball game because they, you know, like I say, speaking aside, they want to keep the momentum going into the playoffs. They won, I believe, 10 or 11 in a row. They lost the first game of the season. Had a tough game last week against Mass and went into overtime, but still won. So they're going to try to keep that momentum going because, you know, what you don't want to do is lose a game right before the playoffs because you never know what type of morale your team is going to have after that. So I expect them to come out in front of their home crowd against a rival team in Orlando, the 1-4, and they're going to give us their all, and they're going to try to embarrass us as much as they can.
Will we be calling the plays on Saturday?
Yes, sir.
Keep the momentum going. And one final question before your closing thoughts of tonight. Has ownership given you a vote of confidence that you will be returning as the Predators head coach?
Have they given me a vote of confidence? That's a tough one to answer. I would hope so. You know, being, you know, the all the extra that we've been through this year, you know, just starting up, being brand new, not as an organization, but, you know, brand new ownership and them learning, you know, what and what not to do, not making the same mistakes we made this year, going into next year. I would hope, you know, given a clean slate, given being dealt a fair hand, you know, being able to have a full off season, being able to get the guys that I want, being able to get a full coaching staff that I want, being able to have all the attributes for the players that they need, I would hope that, you know, I would be able to come back because it wouldn't matter this year if it was me or if it was Jay Gruden coaching this team. It was a tough season. And I would hope with, you know, everything that's needed with my vision of having a successful football team, that they would bring me back.
And it's only fair to bring you back because, you know, no one wants to be dealt a hand without giving another opportunity to, all right, listen, give me a fair hand. I know this hand was kind of raggedy, or I came in on the back end of this hand. I don't know what's been played. And, all right, give me a full hand, now we can go from there.
Right.
So your final thoughts going into Saturday's game, Coach?
Final thoughts going into Saturday's game. You know, we would like for, you know, all the fans that can possibly make it to Jacksonville to come and support, you know, the Predators, you know, for the last game as much as they can. We would love to see, you know, just a sea of Predator fans at that game and just giving the Sharks fans hell. That'll give us a vote of confidence. That'll give our guys, you know, the will to go out and fight. So, you know, for all the fans that can make it to the ball game, please come and support the Preds. And we will, you know, next year have the Preds of old back into the Amway Arena. And we will win ball games. We will make the playoffs. We will win the championship. So if you can, come out and support the Preds Saturday in Jacksonville. You heard it first.
see you back. It's only right. It's only fair. I know that you're a great coach. I've seen it. So it's only right to have the players that you want so that you can coach them the way you want without having to deal with this, or whatever the circumstances were that you had to deal with this season. So best of luck to you, sir, and we'll be talking. Thank you much. That's our time, ladies and gentlemen. Next week is our season finale of Chalk Talk. It's been a pleasure being your host throughout this season. Be sure to tune in on Tuesday night, tomorrow night, for the TJ Chatman Show. We are going to have a great one. So make sure you guys tune in. Keep it locked. The best is yet to come. Let's go.